What really struck me about The Queen's Gambit was that it wasn't at all about chess. It's not about a game, it's about the cost of genius.
It's a story about how you survive in a world when you have a very specific gift that makes you harder to understand.
I think she looks to chess as very much an escape.
Although it tells that story, it's about a child genius and working up to a world level. It's actually still more about her demons.
I spend a lot of time in Beth's head, and that doesn't make sense to a lot of people, but I do find that that is the easiest way to act out of empathy. And that's my favorite kind of acting, because even when it has been written for you by such an incredible writer, when somebody is alone in a room and they're not performing for anybody, that's when you see the true essence of them. And I get a lot of quiet moments with Beth in the show.
What's that game called?
It's called chess.
Chess is a little like music or mathematics in that the people who play it, they become obsessed with it. You see the world as a chessboard. Chess is so cerebral, and there are so many chess players who also went nuts. All of the danger of that, I think, is really interesting. And for me, kind of, the whole story is organized around that.
I think the obsession is a bit of both nature and nurture. I think Beth comes from a family of very, very intelligent people. And when your brain works that quickly, that can sometimes drive you a little bit crazy. But I also think it's the one thing she kind of had going for her. She grew up in quite a bleak setting. She loses her mother, and then she's dumped in an orphanage, and then somebody else grabs her fate and moves it somewhere else. But I do think that she's juggling a very fine line of, like, am I insane or am I a genius? And she doesn't quite know where she sits.
It'll be check once the pawn moves and the knight trades. Can't you see that?
No, I can't. I can't find it that fast.
Well, wish you could.
Feeling like she is in control of at least some of her destiny, or at least her destiny in this miniature world, gives her a great sense of accomplishment and security.
Sometimes people find patterns or meaning where there aren't any.
What does that have to do with me?
Well, creativity and psychosis often go hand in hand.
I do think she's, like, consistently worried that she's a bit crazy.
Beth has visions of seeing a chessboard on the ceiling.
This is in the book. She looks up to the ceiling and imagines the position and the places of the pieces.
Do you ever go over games in your head?
Doesn't everybody?
She is aware that her gift makes her special, and that her gift offers her a way of kind of paying her own way, and it keeps her safe. So I do think that the obsession also comes from a place of necessity.
I'm worried about you.
What on earth for?
The problem with The Queen's Gambit as a movie, I realize once you reduce it too far, it becomes just about the chess. The drug addiction and the other things that happen in the story, there's no room for it.
When we read that book, there just was so many games of chess in it. And we sat there and said, how the heck are we going to do this and make it accessible to people who don't play chess and really authentic to the people for whom it's a beautiful game?
I was trying to mine the idea of the cost of genius. That was only barely in the book. And if you do it as a film, I realized you're never going to be able to touch on that either.
When you extend something, you actually get a much better opportunity. I think the single great contribution of 21st century drama is that you get the time to do things at that kind of length. The overriding interest I've always had is to make it powerfully emotional. And I think that's what Scott shares with me, is that ambition to do that.
There's some people that you're just supposed to know. And I first met Scott, and kind of from the second I walked in, we were both just like, where have you been? Like, this is so exciting. We finally get to do something together, even though I didn't know that you existed. And we just formed a very quick family bond, kind of instantly. And we had the same ideas. He's so enthusiastic about what he's doing, but he really gives you a lot of room to play. He's got a really good understanding of how he wants the show to be. I love him.
I'd worked with Scott before on another show. So as soon as he came along with this other idea, I kind of didn't care what it was about. I knew it was going to be well written. It was going to have some fantastic characters. and it was probably going to look beautiful too. So I was just excited right from the very beginning.
Greens to even your disposition, orange and browns for building a strong body. Take them both.
In the late 50s, it was very common to give children in orphanages tranquilizers to make them easier to handle. So she becomes addicted to tranquilizers and sedatives when she's 9, then discovers alcohol when she's about 15. She's also addicted to winning. Again, when I read the book for the first time, I just really understood that to her, both the pills and the alcohol are kind of like a magic wand. When she's feeling really angry or sad or humiliated, it acts as an obliterator. It just takes it away, and she's able to just stop feeling that intensely and that isolated and alone. And then when she's feeling successful, or when she's feeling like she's done something right, it feels like, oh, this is the perfect companion. Like, I'm now doing things correctly. I'm living the high life. This is the way it's supposed to work. And then obviously with the tranquilizers, she's convinced herself that she's not as sharp without them. It is incredibly sad because it's basically just saying that she just doesn't feel like she's enough without them.
Beth Harmon, this is Roger Dion.
Harmon? The chess prodigy. I've heard so much about you.
Nice to meet you.
When we were talking about casting in terms of Beth, it was a very small target because the lens is on her the whole time, because she is carrying every scene, because you are trying to get inside of her. You are trying to see what's happening inside of her. I needed somebody who drew you in, who was really interesting, who you couldn't stop watching, who could also convey this sense of intelligence and this sense of lots of things happening inside.
You know, certain actors that have a certain sparkle to them, where there's just something kind of engaging and enigmatic about them that just makes you want to kind of look at them and know more about them. And Anya does that as a person and also in her roles as well. It's quite impressive, really.
I really needed somebody who could pull all that off, and it's not a long list. I met her. As sometimes happens, you shake someone's hand and you go, oh, this is the person in my head.
It felt good. I've never won anything before.
I think Scott's very good with ensemble pieces and making all the characters that surround your lead make the story kind of work and to feed the audience what they need to know in order for the story to develop. You feel like you could kind of turn the whole thing around and pick any one of them out and make another whole show just about them.
I'm sorry.
About what?
That you didn't get adopted.
I make out just fine right here.
We were lucky enough to have Moses Ingram play Jolene, who is a fabulous human being and a wonderful actress, and we got along immediately, which is obviously really useful because that is the bond that these two characters have. And I do think there's a very special relationship that forms between people who have experienced a hardship or a very unique situation together, because there's kind of an understanding that nobody else is ever going to understand where they came from. And I love how honest they are with each other. It's a very strangely uncomplicated relationship.
Jolene is honest, straightforward, and a really, really good friend to Beth. I think maybe the closest thing to family, real family, that Beth has had.
I love Jolene, and I'm so glad that that translated and got me here. I think it's like this thing of like, oh, I'm gonna lose a job. So reading everything like 2, 3, 4, 5, 17 times. But it ended up being really, really cool. And everybody made space for me to like learn, and I'm grateful.
I'm working as a paralegal.
You went to college?
I did, Kentucky State. I got a physical education scholarship. But when I found out the school used to be called the State Normal School for Colored Persons, it made me want to study history, which pissed me off way more than I already was.
It's hard to imagine.
I read about your game with Borgov. That must have felt terrible.
Felt like a fool.
I know that feeling. Helpless. It all goes and you just push wood.
Benny Watts, what can you say about an endless source of entertainment for me, personally? Thomas Brodie Sangster is my personal hero for just going for it in the way that he did. There's a lot of Benny's clothes that I, Anya, actually want. I just think they're fabulous. We always said that he looked like he had a crocodile for a pet. The knife for no reason, it's the cowboy hat, the giant leather, almost matrix coat, the shirts that are unbuttoned to the belly button. He's got a really great kimono robe.
I do think that he dresses that way intentionally. He wants to be looked at. I think he wants to have people go, whoa, who's that? Why is he dressed like that? It's quite intimidating. I think he kind of does it as, look how confident I am at being myself. Who are you? And I think he kind of finds that amusing because he has a feeling of control over that. Yeah, I always found that putting the costume on is intrinsic to how you stand, how you feel, how you walk. I love that bit. That's great.
I think Beth's first true connection is with Mr. Scheibel. It's with somebody who she feels understands not only her gift, but how her brain works. Also somebody who can tell her no.
You resign now.
Resign?
That's right, child. When you lose the queen that way, you resign.
I want to finish.
No.
You've got to finish.
No.
Bill Camp, I was so thrilled when he said yes, because truthfully, I don't always get this way, but I was just totally stuck on him doing it. And those scenes in the basement were also great because he gave Isla this masterclass in acting at the top of the shoot. I will never forget. He was helping her. That for me was a really wonderful part of the show.
We're so glad to have an older child.
I've known Marielle Heller for maybe 10, 11 years now, and she has this great, beautiful, old-fashioned face. And I called Marielle, and I offered her the role over the phone. It was great for Anya. They clicked right away, the two of them, and she just fell into it, and she let us change her look, and the first time I saw her on set, I didn't even recognize her. And the other thing is that she was the best backseat director I've ever had. Constantly offering suggestions, and I would tease her about it, but you know what? She was usually right.
I just didn't have the faintest idea that people made money playing chess.
There's tournaments with much bigger prizes than that.
How much bigger?
Thousands of dollars.
Goodness.
So, can we go to the bank today after school?
Certainly.
I think Mrs. Wheatley is a very tricky character. I think a lot of people could see her negatively, and Mari played her with deep empathy, and you do feel for the relationship that both Mrs. Wheatley and Beth have together. I think you understand why they love each other in the way that they do.
Step over here so I can see the fabric in the light. Yes. This will do nicely.
Our wonderful costume designer, Gabrielle, we had so much fun. I mean, there were endless fittings, but all of them were always really enjoyable because she throws herself into it with such a zest.
I think best she defines herself very much about what she's wearing, and she's kind of searching herself and can't find who she is. This is maybe because she's a woman in the male world and she doesn't find really the role models.
She's trying on different identities, and I really felt like I could connect with that because I literally play other people like 3 months at a time. So I'm kind of doing the same thing. It's really fun to see the progression and how she grows in that.
We spend a lot of time talking about where Beth is at in the story. And in the orphanage, it's pretty simple what they're wearing. And Gabriella, you know, designed these great uniforms for the girls. And that would also help Beth look younger. As we go forward, you know, she's more and more glamorous, more trying to be other people. And so we go through all of that, and we kind of very early on started talking about that. And so you have all these very practical conversations tethered to the story.
Didn't she ever change clothes?
In the beginning, she has no choice. She's always determined by other people, by the early dresses, what Mrs. Wheatley buys for her. So when she wins her first tournament, she goes out to buy dresses. And because she has no orientation, she just buys the dresses on the mannequins that she sees. Because she thinks if it's on the mannequin, it must be good. Then she is alone and she discovers jeans and she discovers more her body. She has sex, she wears short skirts, and she discovers also that she has kind of power being feminine.
My stars, you look... Wow.
Thanks.
Clothes are a wonderful way of exhibiting history, and I think the tournament dress from Las Vegas is a perfect example of that, because it's just on the cusp of we are now in the early 60s and Beth is still trying to play grown up, so it's a very conservative dress. This is her I'm a woman phase. We've all been there.
I thought it's a kind of chess expression, give us a little bit the feeling she's the chess queen. This is the Paris water tub dress. This is a dress she just bought new in Paris.
I have a lot of deep love for that dress. We spent a lot of time soaking wet and cold together, so I feel like it's kind of like my sister in arms. Probably my favorite section of Beth's clothes actually is the whole Moscow tournament. She just gets to rock around in all of these incredible monochromatic outfits, which made me feel much cooler than I really am. So thank you, Beth.
The very end, when she's kind of finally comfortable in the world of chess, Gabriella found this beautiful long white coat with this white hat for Moscow because it's very cold, and you realize she looks like the White Queen. Hair and makeup is a different sort of collaboration than the production design, costume design. It's less about the overall look, but it obviously has to play with everything else. You want to be able to look at someone and they need to look like who they are.
Makeup and hair can tell us everything about a culture, an era. You can immediately, if you see the hair, you see the makeup, you know where they are. You know, Kentucky was shooting in the 1950s, New York was shooting in the late 60s. And so New York, I've taken the beatnik side of New York, the kind of more hip side, starting with the hippies as well. And then the earlier stuff is like straight America. And then Paris, you've got Paris, they're a little bit more quirky. So everybody has to look where they come from. And it can be tiny little differences, but if you don't make those differences, it's just not going to work. I always drive everybody mad. I say, well, where are these people from? What year? And so once I know that, then I can design their makeups, and of course see their costume as well. It's very important. When I first read the script, I had in my mind that Beth was a redhead, just from the character that she is within the script. Funny enough, Anya also felt this.
In the book, Beth has brown hair, and immediately when I first read it, I walked in, the first thing I said to Scott was, I was like, she needs to have red hair because I want her to be other and completely identifiable, even if she doesn't want to be, and he had thought the exact same thing, so we just started off on a really good foot. It was all wigs. I was very happy to dye my hair. There are days when we were going between 5 different ages in a day, and that's just not possible with your own hair. So we had Baby Beth, we had Sexy Kitten, and we had Glamour Puss.
Her journey plays a lot with the makeup, because she's up and down, alcohol, drugs, everything. And so, of course, the makeup and hair does a lot for that.
The makeup evolution of Beth was really, really fun to chart because there's a lot of experimentation going on there. And there's a really wonderful moment, actually, where she sees Mariska Veras and she tries to copy the look. It's really wild and it's so much fun. And as somebody who's very technically inept with makeup, it's really fun to get to play with professionals that can actually realize all of these things.
To sell the age, the younger, the less makeup. The haircuts are younger. She's less looked after. She goes up a stage, she discovers makeup. So we start off with a little bit of lipstick and a little bit of blusher, a little bit of brown mascara. But the other things are little small tricks, like I get individual eyelashes, and the older she gets, she basically gets more of these eyelashes, so her eyes become sexier. But they're very, very small adjustments, and you don't see them. until you start seeing her older, and then the black eyeliner goes on. You definitely see rouge, you definitely see lipstick, but then she's meant to have it because she's older. So it's an enormous amount of work to do something like this, but that's the job and that's what you take on, and that's what makes it interesting. It's challenging.
Uli Hanush, I came to Berlin because I wanted to work with him.
You would ask yourself, why would you come with an American production? And then we realized that because of the history of Berlin, we have both the West, we have the East, we have the elegance, we have the Soviet Union kind of intimidating architecture, we have the modern 60s.
Exciting about the show was the time and the 50s, 60s America.
We were shooting Paris, Russia, Las Vegas, and pieces of New York and Lexington, Kentucky, all here.
The one that blew my mind, I just said, we can do pretty much everything here, except I can't believe we could do Mexico City in Berlin.
The whole crew would come on the set, and you would hear 50 people, 100 people oohing and aahing about these locations.
Every time I got to go onto a new set, I was always completely blown away by the way that it looked. And it was always kind of exciting. It was sort of like going into a different segment of Disney World where you're like, ah, so this is what Epcot looks like. Amazing.
I love the dormitory at the orphanage is a gorgeous set. The orphanage itself is a gorgeous set. The basement where she plays with Mr. Scheibel is the most beautiful looking basement I've ever seen. All this stuff, they all look very real. They have a personality. They all feel connected to the same show, but they're also really interesting to look at and eminently shootable. Everywhere you look, there's something you want to find a way to include in the shot or to use somehow in the storytelling.
Have you joined a club?
I'm playing in that chess tournament I told you about.
The whole subject of chess and the chess tournaments, which is like an entire world on its own behalf, we wanted to make the whole thing like a journey for her. So every tournament is meant to be different. And it's also meant to symbolize something else, also her progress, and everything is getting bigger and more exciting and more exotic. At the same time, we do always the same thing, because what she does is traveling and playing chess at tournaments, and then traveling and playing chess at tournaments. So we have hotel rooms, airplanes, hotel lobbies, restaurants, and whatever kind of ballroom for each tournament. So in a way, it is very much the same repeating. So it was our target to repeat.
To make it different.
Different.
Yeah, exactly.
With Las Vegas, I was bound and determined to right away sell the place in the first shot. And so the best way to do it was to follow her in. I just wanted to keep it simple and not call attention to itself, but call attention to the space. That was sort of what it was really about.
One of my favorite sets were the department store.
Yeah, I think this is like one of the secret dreams of people like us, being able to go shopping in a department store of another period, and now we had to come up with it.
Shall we? For me, especially the Wheatley house was a big pleasure. Not bad taste, but special taste. So it was full of flowers, and the wallpapers were flowers, and the curtains and everything was matching together, and we were really putting new fabrics on sofas so that everything is matching.
I have a favorite set piece, which is Beth buys herself a bright jewel turquoise velvet couch. And the first time I saw that couch, I just desperately fell in love, and I will own that couch in my future, in my home.
There was this scene in Mexico. I wasn't even working that day, and I just happened to go. There is an amazing level of detail in all the sets. Amazing.
The Paris Hotel and chess tournament was incredible. I think it was an old restaurant.
This here is a pretty special location in Berlin. It's the House Cumberland. It was built as a boarding house and was abandoned for a long time. It used to be used as a film location, and we turned it into a hotel in Paris. This is supposed to be like the most elegant European kind of cultural event she's facing. And we turned the whole thing into a working hotel lobby, bit of a restaurant, and in the background, you can see the ballroom for the tournament.
When we talk about Paris, we try to add the gold into the chessboard also on the clock, so we try to even match the gold part into those detailed things.
Benny's apartment was interesting because we shot the exterior in Toronto, and we found a row of like three structures that looked right that we could shoot from a very limited angle and sell it.
What?
He designed this basement apartment that was amazing. And right away, I started changing the scene because of so many good things in the set.
I thought I was gonna get a couch.
Oh, I said living room. Just gotta pump it up.
I got it.
Really? You sure? Gonna be all right?
Sure.
You get a feeling that this kind of period and this vibe, this feel, existed once. Even if you weren't alive during that time, it kind of, whenever I look into the camera, it looks familiar in some ways. What's so cool is that you just get all these very talented people that all come together and make this one thing. And then it's your responsibility as an actor to come in and live up to the standards that everyone else is setting. And it's a lovely collaboration of people. That's one of the things I like most about being part of this world.
If there's anybody else in the room, the only person you're looking at is Anya. She conveys an intelligence, and yet there's a kind of vulnerability there, and you sense something dark rippling all the time.
With any character, it's just about understanding where they come from. And yes, Beth is a genius, but she's also, for a large portion of this, a 15-year-old girl, a 16-year-old girl, somebody who's desperately trying to connect, somebody who's unbelievably lonely. It broke my heart when I first read it, and it continues to break my heart still. You know, I really, really care about this woman. I think some people would think that being born a genius or being born with such an incredible gift doesn't have a price to it. And I think having the opportunity to spend time with Beth in this way and not just see all of the wins, but all of the hard work that it takes to get to the wins or the sacrifices that it takes to get to the wins. I think hopefully that just builds a lot of empathy for somebody who I selfishly really, really care about.
Could you stop the car, please? I'd like to walk.
Finally, at the end of the story, she realizes who she is and finds sort of a comfort in just her own self. And for me, that's really the journey, is this person who thinks of herself, as she says very early on, as white trash. And not particularly beautiful, even though she is, and not particularly intelligent, even though she is. And so she has this urge to destroy everybody. By the end, it doesn't matter. She just loves the game. She just loves to play the game, and she's happy being herself. And I think the ending really is all about that.
Graham.